Hello, everyone, and welcome to episode 28 of the RocknRoll Beer Guy Podcast. This episode is brought to you by Wendigo Tea Company. Please go to wendigotea.com and check out their selection of wonderful organic natural teas. I recommend the Siren Throat Coat, which is great for singers and podcasters alike, or the Wendigo Green Tea, which I'm drinking right now, and it's like an orgasm for my mouth. This episode is also brought to you by Audible. If you go to audibletrial.com/RRBG, you can get yourself a free 30-day trial and a free audiobook from a selection of over 180,000 titles. That's a lot of books. In this episode, I talked to Stavros Giannopoulos. He is the guitarist and vocalist for the band The Atlas Moth. We geek out about comic books for quite a bit. We talk a bit about music and the new Atlas Moth record that's coming out February 9th. And we give our full breakdown and predictions for WWE Summerslam. I had a great time nerding out with him, and I hope you enjoy. Cheers. Doing all right, brother. How you doing?
I'm good, man. Fucking living the dream.
You know, it's funny. I have a friend of mine that I used to work with in Florida, and every single day I'd call him up and just be like, "Hey, man, how you doing?" He's like, "Living the dream, brother. Why do you even ask?
He's like, "Because you live in Florida." I don't know what the hell's going on down there, man. It's like a true land of mystery in my eyes.
Oh, no, and it's all true, everything you've heard.
Oh, I know. Yeah. I have so many. I'm actually, after I'm done with this interview, my really good friend Erica, who actually told me to say hi to the podcast.
Hi.
I'm going to pick her up, and we're going to go to a show, and she is from Florida. So, I'm so well-versed in Floridian bizarreness, it's not even funny.
Well, cool. I hope you have like an hour though.
Oh yeah. Listen, I have all the time in the world.
Cool, because I want to talk to you about music and shit, but I also want to do a full on breakdown of SummerSlam with you.
Oh, listen, here's the deal. We can talk less about music and more about wrestling, and I'm way happier.
So awesome. Yeah.
Let's go for it, man. Yeah. Cool. I talk about music all the time. I'm always looking to talk about wrestling.
Cool. I'm just going to do a little bit for the listeners that may not be familiar. How about that? Just a little bit.
Oh, yeah, of course. Yeah. I mean, I'm joking around. I know that my main goal here is for the music thing, you know, but let's talk some fucking wrestling for sure.
For sure. So welcome, everyone, to the RocknRoll Beer Guy Podcast. I am here with, let's see if I get this right, Stavros Giannopoulos.
Stavros, but yes, quite good on the last name. That's the Stavros, yes.
Stavros. Cool.
Mm-hmm.
Is that Greek?
Yeah, quite Greek. If you couldn't tell.
Yeah, right. I mean, honestly, you sound like a character out of Game of Thrones.
You know what? I don't watch Game of Thrones. Which is like one of those things. I'm a little lost on that. My girlfriend always is bitching at me about how I need to watch it, but I have too many nerd things that I like already. So I can't add any more, you know? Like my entire life is based on suspension of belief, you know? Like I'm playing in a band. Right. That's suspending belief. I really like comic books and I love pro wrestling and horror movies. You know what I'm saying? So I can't add another element in here. You know, I have to have some sort of reality in my life. So well, Game of Thrones doesn't make the cut.
As a avid comic book fan, wrestling fan, horror fan and music fan, I got to tell you, dude, you got to watch Game of Thrones.
See, you know, for the longest time now, I've been sitting here being like, the only people that really like Game of Thrones are people that don't want to admit they watch porno. Because everything that everyone always tells me, like, dude, there's so much sex. And it's like, who cares? Like, you know, like oh, there's so much, you know, like, there's so much violence and sex. Like, I don't care.
Yeah.
You know, like, it doesn't matter to me, you know? Like, I also have a really hard time with anything with, like, Dungeons and Dragons and swords. Like, I don't even like Braveheart.
Oh.
You know? Well, yeah, see? Like, I know that I'm probably wrong. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm okay with that, too.
Well, you know what? I think we're done here.
Podcast. Easiest interview ever. Yeah, you're fucking done.
No, I hear you, man. And the fantasy thing does – I'm not, like,
super into it. I get into it. I like Lord of the Rings. I like Braveheart, stuff like that. But I'm also like, that's not my favorite thing. My favorite thing is sci-fi shit. Like, you know.
Yeah. See, like that's more my like horror sci-fi. Like I fucking love Star Wars. Obviously, like yeah. I'm a fucking nerd. You know, like I'm a total dork. I love Star Wars. I can tell you about all like the weird characters in the cantina. You know what I'm saying? Like, I mean, I collect toys. You know what I'm saying? Like, I just got enough shit, man. And you know, I never liked Lord of the Rings. I never liked the only thing I can honestly say I ever liked in the fantasy realm is Willow, which is so okay. random and weird. But I was a child of the 80s, you know.
Well, it's also a Lucasfilm, right?
Is it?
I think it is. No,
I think he wrote it. Maybe.
Okay.
I'm gonna IMDb that while we're on the phone. I don't know. You know. Now I'm curious. but yeah, that's the only thing I can get into with like swords and stuff. You okay. know, and yeah. knights in shining armor and the such. It's directed by Ron Howard.
Ron Howard. Okay. Never yes. mind. I'm just making shit up then.
The writer is George Lucas. You were on top.
Oh, there
of
we
that.
Go.
So yeah, maybe that makes sense. Yeah, there we go. We cracked the code on that one.
Yeah. all us 80s kids are, you know, just loyal fans of Lucas.
Well, you know, sort of, but yeah.
up until the Jar Jar situation, but we're not going to get into that.
I don't even know what you're talking about. Okay. That never happened in my world.
Oh man, I'm so glad they've kind of, you know, come back from that nightmare. Like, I really like.
Yeah, Force dude, Awakens. Force Awakens was great. I hate everybody that was like, it's just a New Hope again. Just chill out, dude. It was great. I cried when Han died. Spoiler alert, everybody.
Oh,
And then like fucking Rogue One was awesome. I thought.
Yeah. That was great. We finally get to see Darth Vader being a badass. You know?
Thank God. Yeah, you know, because like the last time we really saw prequels, that didn't happen. like, was he saving Luke? And I always hated Luke. You know. I mean, right. Who cares? Who cares about Luke?
Yeah, I mean, I care about him in the extended universe, which they have then banished. But you know, I got into the books after that came like what were supposed to be 7, 8, and 9,
right?
And they were awesome, dude. He learns the dark side. He puts balance to the Force as predicted, and opens the academy up. Like all that stuff is really cool in the books.
Yeah, see, like I read a bunch of those when I was like shit, maybe 12 and 13. So we're going on. God, a long time ago, like 20 years ago, you know, so I'm a little bit rusty on that. But I recall loving them, you know, especially in the time frame when there was like really no Star Wars media out there. You know, there wasn't cartoons. There was like a comic book, you know, and there weren't any movies on the horizons. You know, there weren't any like toys or anything. There wasn't like this whole weird Star Wars renaissance we're going through right now, you know. Yeah. So which I'm glad about, you know, like I have two nephews and a niece and my brother, who took me to go see Star Wars, they're his kids. And when Force Awakens came out, me and him took his three kids, who I took his oldest son to go see, I think, Attack of the Clones. You know, so there was like, three generations of our family sitting there watching this. You know, it was like, to me, that was like super special. You know, I was like, this is really cool. I'm glad that, you know, this kind of stuff kind of came full circle. Because it didn't seem like it would for a long time, you know?
Yeah. No, I got to give props to Disney, dude. They've been there my whole life. Like, a lot of people hate on them, and that's corporate bullshit. But, dude, that Disney's – I was a kid. I grew up on Disney cartoons. I grew up with Star Wars, which is now under the Disney umbrella. I grew up with comic books, which are now on – pretty much Marvel is under the Disney umbrella, and that's, you know.
But that's, like, what matters, right? You know? I mean, I think Warner Brothers is shit on DC enough that I really have a hard time taking it seriously at this point. But,
It's so stupid over there. I don't know who's doing shit over there, but it's not good, guys.
Stop. Dude, seriously, like someone needs to hire a dork that's gonna fix that shit, because it is fucked up. I watched Wonder Woman the other day, which I missed in theaters because like me and my girlfriend, if we don't see it like opening weekend, we probably won't. It's like one of those things, you know, and she works a ton and, you know, yada yada yada. But anyway, I finally saw it the other day. And, you know, this entire time, everyone's been like, oh, man, awesome, you know, like strong woman lead in a film, you know, yada, yada, yada. And I'm like, you know, by all means, like I'm for a strong woman lead, you know, like I have a little niece that like, you know, is that needs a Wonder Woman out there, you know. And sure. And I hate how they're like, instead of making awesome new female characters, they just like, oh, now Thor's a woman, you know,
right,
like,
dude.
Like, come on, man. Like, that's like almost like that's just as misogynistic as not having any, you know, like female characters. And then Wonder Woman turned into like, oh, hey, you want to know why Diana wants to go and save the world? It's because some square jawed, like, you know, like above average good looking dude shows up on her island. Like, that's like ridiculous. Like, I was like, dude, this is fucked up, man. Like, this is the exact same thing, you know, like. So yeah, fuck that. Fuck like all the DC stuff minus the Nolan stuff.
Right. Yeah, I love Nolan stuff. yeah. Actually, I did, I guess I told myself that I enjoyed Wonder Woman, and I think it's mostly because the other ones are so bad.
True. Yeah, no. Yo, that's a real thing. Like, I definitely liked it. I'll tell you what, I really liked Batfleck in Batman vs. Superman. I think he might be the most well-rounded Batman Bruce Wayne, honestly. But we'll see. So check it out here. I'll have to defend this now. We're just going to get right into it. I always felt Michael Keaton's my Batman, okay. You know? Like, for sure. He's my Batman, but I thought he was a shitty Bruce Wayne. He was
a maniac.
Yeah, totally. Yeah, he wasn't good at all. And then I thought Bale. Well, let's not even do Clooney and Kilmer. That doesn't count. But yeah, exactly. So Christian Bale, on the other hand, though, was a perfect Bruce Wayne playboy, young millionaire that needs to, hide his dark side. So he's like, you know, taking the entire Russian ballet out on his fucking cruise ship. You know what I'm saying? It was perfect. But then his Batman was just so flat. You know, and I feel as though the 40-something-year-old Ben Affleck playing an older, jaded Bruce Wayne, who is just a ruthless, almost horror-esque Batman, was fucking perfect. Now, granted, wrapped around that piece of garbage movie did not really help it at all. But that's a thing, you know? Like, I'm looking forward to, I think it's called The Batman, which he's supposed to direct and star in. I think that might be a winner.
He dropped out of directing it.
Great.
People were already worried that he's just going to quit overall, but no, I think Ron Howard. He's doing fucking Lando.
Oh, it's right.
The Han Solo movie.
I
forget who it is, but whoever. Ben Affleck dropped out of directing it. I liked him more than I thought I would. I really liked the entire time leading up to it. I'm like, man, Ben Affleck's like fucking Philadelphia cream cheese, man. I can't. I can't deal with that. That's not Batman.
Yo, pull it off. I was the first, not the first person, but I definitely, the day that it was announced, I signed the petition to get him removed as Batman. Okay. I totally was that dude on the internet. I'd be like, yep, I'm with this one, guys. Fuck Ben Affleck. I hate Kevin Smith. You know, the whole nine yards. Like, let's just get let's get this done with. And then I thought he was the best part of that movie. So that's, I don't know. That's me, though. I've argued with this. I've actually been slapped by a friend when I said that to him. So I've taken some considerable amount of shit for it, but I'm going to stand by it. If he knocks it out of the park as Batman, though, I really have to say we might have to start taking him a bit more seriously. He's gotten some good movies out there, too. I mean, Gone Girl was great, you know, and what was that other one? The Accountant? That was great.
Yeah. So here's the issue with what's going to happen with the Batman. They have to do a story with the Joker. That was the Dark Knight's villain.
Yeah.
It was the Joker. And Jared Leto's Joker fucking blows.
Okay, so check it out. That's something that I haven't really put into the equation. You're right. That was fucking god-awful. Yeah. Damn it.
So, unless they recast, if they recast for some reason, or maybe they just do an older Joker, like he's past this point of being a gangster, and now he's older and more crazy, then okay, maybe. But I don't know, dude.
Maybe,
know,
but that's a strong, that's a big stretch. Yeah, I don't know either. I heard it was supposed to be Deathstroke in the movie, which I was kind of curious about. I thought that was an interesting one, but honestly, dude, I really felt as though we got robbed of a third great Batman movie with Heath Ledger dying. Yeah. And I really, unfortunately, in all honesty, this could actually still work out really well, especially because I felt that there was, like I said, a horror element to Ben Affleck's Batman. I really felt as though now bringing in a Saw-esque Riddler would be fucking killer.
Yeah.
You know, like straight up Jigsaw Riddler could be fucking awesome. But who knows? That all depends on how that works out. And also, they got to sell toys, so I'm not going to get an R-rated one. You know?
Right. Yeah, that's not going to happen. I hear you with the Jigsaw Riddler, because it's kind of like the Riddler from the video games. The Arkham Asylum and all that. Like, he's got puzzle rooms. And,
right.
Yeah, that'd be kind of cool.
Yeah, it would be fucking great. You know, and I really thought, especially, I really was expecting them to go Riddler for the third Nolan film. And I thought Nolan is just so clever, and he's a genius in my eyes, filmmaking-wise. And I thought that him figuring out what fucking traps the Riddler would make would be pretty intense. Yeah. You know, but nonetheless, that's not gonna happen, so chalk it on up.
We could have gotten some of those really cool Inception, the walls of the building are moving around kind of thing, you know. That would have been cool.
Dude, exactly, dude. Think about, oh god. We totally were cheated. Man was cheated by this one for sure.
Yeah. Well, hopefully, hopefully all this bullshit with DC will eventually die out and they'll restart it again and do it right. I mean, they got Josh Whedon over there now. Josh Whedon's helping him. Yeah. He's helping out with Justice League. He's doing reshoots and fixing dialogue and shit like that. So
as long as Josh Whedon doesn't end it, it might be okay. Because Josh Whedon doesn't know how to end a story to save his fucking life. That's how I feel very strongly about that. He does not know how to end like a thing at all. Like Angel 2 was a bad ending. You know, like everything he's done ends poorly. You know, like it's like, man, you just really just – you put it all out there in the front end of it. And then when it gets to the fucking last third, you're just like, yep, that's it. Not movie-wise, but story arc over, like, trilogies or something like that, you know?
Yeah. I'm hoping they don't ruin Infinity War. Thanos is seriously one of my favorite comic book characters of all time.
Dude, I mean, how old are you?
I'm 36.
Okay, so I'm 34, right? So, like, do you remember going into a comic book store as a kid and seeing that cover for Infinity Gauntlet where it's just Thanos standing there, like, in that field of, like, the asteroids and it just says, come and get me or something like that? That was the coolest fucking thing I've ever seen in my entire life when I was a kid.
I got to send you some pictures once we're done with this. You can see my Thanos collection is absurd.
Dude, yeah, I am a huge Gauntlet fan. And from what I've seen of what they've shown at Comic-Con, that thing looks fucking amazing. I think that those two guys that did Civil War and what's it called? Winter Soldier are fucking incredible.
Yeah.
So if they're doing these two, I got the utmost faith. And I think that Kevin Feige is not going to screw us, you know? He hasn't really – the only movie I haven't really dug in recent times of the MCU has been Doctor Strange. So I did, but it was just like – I can't even tell you what Mads Mikkelsen's character's name was. You know? Like it was – there was a little bit like – I thought Cumberbatch was great and I thought – I mean I love Doctor Strange. I love how like Jack Kirby-esque the ending got because that's like my main influence art-wise. Like that's how I learned how to draw was, you know, drawing Jack Kirby stuff from comic books. So, like, I was really into that, and I was, like, super excited. But, like, I actually took my phone out in the middle of that movie to see what time it was. You know, and I've never done that, really, in the theaters, ever. So it just didn't strike me, you know? Like,
I went super baked, so I think that might have made a difference.
I'll tell you what, I did go see the second Thor movie super baked, and for a long time I said that was my favorite MCU movie. It may have been because I was on an incredible amount of edibles. And that Asgardian funeral just fucking blew my mind. So
I went to Guardians 2 on an edible as well, and it was nice.
Nice. Listen, there's no one better than Snake Plissken to be your dad. You know what I'm saying? If Indiana Jones wasn't your dad, then please make it Snake Plissken, dude. Like that's what's up.
Oh shit, for sure. So you let's kind of divert a little bit. So you play in the band Atlas Moth.
I sure do. Atlas Moth. Yes, I do. On my better days.
On your better days. do you do the main vocals? There's very little information, by the way. Like I tried looking up some stuff, and aside from the music, which I've heard, it's just I was looking for like details so I wouldn't just ask boring questions. But there's not a lot.
Right. Yeah, so so one of the big things is like – so I do all the screaming and the rhythm guitar. You know, one thing that like when I was growing up, and you can probably attest to this as well, being of the same age, was that like, do you remember like when a band would put out a new record and like they would update their website, right? And you'd get like, oh wow, new pictures, you know, four of them. You know, like and like, wow, their website's so much cooler now. Something has like an animated GIF in here, you know, like and then you know, they would do a tour or two and then you wouldn't know. You know, there'd be like some mystery still to the bands that you loved because you didn't know what the fuck they were doing. You didn't know like what they were eating for lunch today. You know, they weren't live tweeting their fucking tour. That's kind of stuff that like I kind of miss, you know. So like I'm not really, although I know it's a necessary evil. And granted, I am a guy on social media and I use it for a lot of fun for my own entertainment, you know. But I really like the idea of bands not putting it all out there. You know, I'm not necessarily like a Ghost or a Slipknot-esque where you just don't know, although I do love the mystery behind that kind of stuff. Like, who are these guys? You know, like, but I kind of like the idea of like, hey, listen, what really matters here is these songs. You know, like, it doesn't matter, like, all this other extracurricular bullshit that you can sit here and look at online and see us loading into a show or whatever. Like, that doesn't matter. You know, and in the last couple years, we've been seriously writing this record like at our own pace and not trying to rush it and it's been great that way without putting a bunch of shit out there. Like, I kind of like the idea of people not knowing everything about us, you know, like I don't think you need to. I think like what's more most important here is the music.
Yeah.
You know, like that's what matters. And that's what really should be the focus here. It shouldn't matter. Like, you know, like I said, you know, us dicking around in the bus on tour, you know, like, I mean, that's like shit that I always liked about seeing like the home videos that Pantera would put out. That was cool. That was like the one time you got to see it. It wasn't something that like was just out there for free all the time. So the mysterious aspect has definitely been a big thing in the last 2 years as we've been sitting here writing this record. You know, like I like not letting everybody know. You know, I don't think everybody needs to know. So yeah, we kind of like we don't really put a ton out there. You know, and I think that's kind of fun.
Yeah, no, I like it, dude. I like what you're doing with that. I agree with you. But I also see the other side of it because a lot of fans want to connect to their, you know, musicians that they love and feel that they are like them, I guess, you know, like, okay, he's normal and he goes to Del Taco too. You
know, shit. I do love Del Taco.
So like shit like that, it's cool for a fan to connect like that. But I get how that invades privacy also. And like, you know, you now have to be a little more careful with what you're posting. Cause you know, if you post like, hey, what's up, I'm at this Del Taco, it's so good. And then you'll have fans show up there, you know?
Yeah. I mean, I don't necessarily know if we're on the level of having fans show up at my Del Taco while I'm eating, you know, some shrimp tacos or anything, but like, right. I do agree. That's a thing, you know, like privacy is a thing for sure. You know? And, but I mean, I'm like more in the tip of where it's like, hey man, like, why don't, you know, like, do you need to know what we're doing all the time? And like, why do I need to put, I do see the other side of it, like as far as like people wanting to connect. And like, you know, I mean, you hit me up once and I was like, yeah, let's do it. I'm always available for people for sure. But I don't think everyone needs to know, like, while I'm sitting around, you know, like we practice 3 times a week. Like, do I need to tweet about that every fucking time we do it? Like sometimes we show up at rehearsal and we play one riff for 3 hours because we're trying to figure out how to do it right. It's really not that exciting. Like, and like sometimes, you know, it's better in my eyes, you know, like you don't need to know how they make the hot dogs. You know what I'm saying? Sometimes you just need to enjoy the hot dog.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, so I definitely like, I love being able to connect to people because that was something growing up that like I always yearned to do with guys that, you know, like I looked up to in, as far as musicians go and anything in all honesty. But I'm you know, we're pretty easy guys to get a hold of. And I know that I'm always, you know, people hit me up all the time on Facebook or whatever and I'll chat with anybody. I don't give a fuck. You know, like I'm a pretty sociable dude, you know, and but like, you know, hey. Fucking just because I'm not sitting there updating our Facebook and trying to sell everybody a t-shirt every other day, you know, like that, which is annoying as fuck to me. It's like, you know, come on, guys, stop fucking pushing your goddamn t-shirts, you know, like they're out there, you know, like, I mean, I get it, you know, but also, you know, having a little bit of like, hey, yeah, you don't need to know our entire process. You don't need me to tell you, oh, hey, guess what? We book studio time 3 months from now. No. How about this? When we go in the studio like we did, boom, I put up some studio footage. You know, like it's a little more, you got to find more exciting ways to get people talking. And I feel like, you know, if you put so much shit out there, then no one's ever going to pay attention to the big stuff, you know, and I focus on the big stuff. You know, that's kind of how I've always looked at it.
Yeah, it's difficult, man. It's hard, especially social media is making it harder for us with creating, you know, trying to release something. You know, they're filtering out the amount of people that see your post. So like, let's say you just post up that studio footage, they have a way of, you know, throttling the how many people see that shit,
you know? Yeah, I know, and that's fucking ridiculous, you know. Like I feel like that's so counterproductive to what the entire idea was, you know. And in turn, like, I'm looking forward to the day where maybe some of this changes somehow and maybe Facebook isn't our main source of information for stuff like this, who knows, you know. Like, I'm not a tech guy, so I don't know what's cooking out there in the world, you know. But I think it's like I think the entire thing has kind of jumped the shark, you know. And I feel as though there'll be some sort of change in that. And you know, and the other thing is too, man, like, you know, if people really care, then people are gonna find out. That's how I always look at it too, you know. Like, I'm not here to push anything down anybody's throat. You know, and there's so much music to consume, and I myself as a consumer can't consume it all either. So I don't expect everyone to do that themselves, you know? So I figured if I put my focus on putting out best product I can, then that would, you know, I guess the proof's in the pudding, man. You know, the cream will rise or whatever, you know, saying you want to go with here, you know? Like, yeah. So That's how I look at it, at least, you know.
Yeah, so you guys are working on a new album. I mean, the last one came out, what, 14, 15?
2014, man. It's been a minute, man. Yeah, we were supposed to go into the studio, like, end of last year. And then, you know, my father got sick, so I kind of, like, we kind of put things on hold for a little bit. And then we were supposed to do it in January, and then, like, we just didn't feel like we were ready. And then we kind of got to the point where we were like, you know what, man? Like, we've been sitting here working on this record for so long, and we haven't pushed, like, getting it done or rushing it or anything. So, like, why are we doing that for any of this? Any of the process of this should not be rushed or pushed or forced, mm-hmm. right? So, like, we were very much on the tip of, like, you know, man, let's just sit back, and when we're ready to record, we're going to record, you know, and that's just how it works. So we got in the studio with Sanford Parker, who around Chicago has always been a pretty big name. And in the metal world in general, he's recorded, you know, Yob and shit, you know, I Hate God, all sorts of fucking bands. And, you know, he's a really close friend of mine. He's one of my best friends in the world. So it was kind of like, hey, Sanford, let's do this, man. You know, him and I did two Twilight records together. So him and I have, like, a lot of experience in the studio and working with each other. And yeah, so we got in there at the beginning of June. I think it was the 2nd of June. And we did 2 weeks there. And then it's being mixed right now in Germany by this guy named Lasse Lamert, I think.
Okay.
It's a German name I can't pronounce. but he actually mixed and mastered our last – we put out a split 7-inch with Ken Mode, I think last year or 2 years ago now.
Yeah.
He mixed and mastered that song. So we were really excited about that, and I was a really big fan of how that came out. So he's mixing it right now, and hopefully we should be hearing the – final mix here in the next couple of weeks, you know, and then I just gotta get this artwork done.
Very cool.
But looks like it'll be out in February of next year is what we're shooting for.
Nice. Yeah, and you got some shows coming up. I saw you're playing a show with Perturbator.
Perturbator, yeah, right. I think that's how you say it.
All right, Perturbator, yeah.
It's pretty cool. Yeah, I've always been a big fan of, like, the mixed genre bill, you know.
Yeah.
Especially when it comes to doom stuff, or I mean, I don't really necessarily think we're a doom band really, but you know, like, we've done those shows where it's like, yeah, four doom bands. Awesome. And it's like, oh, cool. Four bands.
By the third hour, I'm asleep.
by the first, you know, fucking 45 minutes, I've had enough doom, you know? You know, so I'm kind of into the idea of playing to some people that have never even heard us, maybe, or just heard of us, or friends of ours that wouldn't necessarily go to a metal show, probably come to a Perturbator show, you know, and. And the other thing too is that doing that in Chicago, because obviously this is our home, you know, like, I think people have seen us with, you know, this band and that band, you know, like, we've played with every doom band you can imagine here, from I Hate God, Neurosis, you know, we've played with all of them, you know.
You played with Gojira, right?
Yeah, totally. Yeah. We played with so many metal bands here, you know, it's like, why don't we just play something different, man? You know?
Yeah. Well, you know, I think the fan base for Perturbator is very, you know, it's a lot of metal dudes with their girlfriends.
Totally. Absolutely. Yeah. And, like, a lot of people have always said that we're like the metal band that people that don't like metal like. So in that regard, you know, that's, yeah, whatever that means, you know, like, I'll take it, I guess, you know, like, I don't necessarily like a ton of metal, you know, like, so at least not anymore, you know, but my tastes are varied for sure. I've been rocking the Jackie Brown soundtrack in my car for like 3 weeks. So
really?
Yeah, okay. I'm a big fan of anything funk and soul and all that shit, and huge on it. So, you know, I'm pretty across the board, and I think that probably comes across in our music a bit, you know. So I think that it makes sense, you know, to kind of switch it up.
For sure. You know, it's funny you mentioned that, like, what, like, getting to this age and what I'm listening to now, I it's what happened to my father is happening to me, which is that he after a certain year, he stopped listening to the music.
Right. Yeah, totally. Exactly.
He started going backwards.
Yeah, exactly. And I always, like, oh, I'll never be that guy. And I'm like, nah, I'm totally that guy.
Yeah.
And it's nothing, you know, in all honesty too, it's not even, as much as it might be a little bit cynical or whatever, or like, I might be able to point at, like, oh yeah, cause I'm getting older and jaded, or I play music, so I think a lot of it has to do with time, you know, like, especially nowadays, like, I can't go from, you know, being on tour and walking off stage and getting in the van and putting on some metal record, you know, that just is not what I want to hear, you know. Right. And like, and also, like, just I've heard so much, I've always been more attracted to any band that, you know, doesn't just sound, you know, the same. Or like these throwback bands, no matter how good they are, and I've heard some that are just excellent, you know, like absolutely incredible bands. But I've heard it, you know, like, I kind of want to hear something new, you know. So, like, and that's, you know, it just attracts me to other kind of shit,
You know?
Very cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I typically listen to what I know, and then I occasionally have this, like, there's this website that I go to that they just post new stuff, like, that I typically enjoy. So I'll download it and I'll listen to it. But a lot of the times I'm just listening to old records or old things. And then I depend on my girl. She shows me like more electronic stuff or slower stuff. And like, you know, like Crosses from the Deftones or.
Totally. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. You know, the other thing is too, is like, it's kind of fun. Like, especially being like such a metal dude and I've been listening. I went to my first show when I was 5 and it was Metallica, you know, like I've literally been in this world forever. You know, and it's kind of fun when I like, you know, can go to like whatever, like an electronic thing. Like I went and saw Ghost or Ghost or whatever that is, whatever you say it, just G-O-S-T.
Yeah.
You know? And like I'm sitting there and I'm like, you know what? I think this is really cool. And it's like I don't know. There's not like I'm so out of the loop that I don't have that like, you know, nerd being like, oh, well, you like that guy? Oh, you're not that cool. You know, so it's like sort of like someone being like, oh, yeah, man, I really like Lamb of God, you know, and I'm like, oh, OK, you know, whatever. Like, it's not that like, you know, I'm telling you you're wrong because I know better. But there's no one I don't know what's cool in that world. You know, I don't know what is like the neurosis in the electronic world. You know, I mean, I might be listening to the Slipknot. You know, so I don't know.
Yeah.
You know, so I kind of like the non-judgmental aspect of it too. You know, it's like, oh, well, I don't know this world, and I can literally just take this at face value. If I like it, I like it. Cool. You know,
exactly. Yeah. As I've gotten older too, I've given less fucks too. So it's like, you know, before when I was a kid, it was like, oh, if I listen to that band, my friends are gonna give me shit about it. But now it's like, dude, yes,
totally.
I don't care what you're talking about. Yeah.
Like, I'm so on that tip. It's not even funny. Yeah. It's like, yeah, I don't care. Yeah. Like, I like Justin Timberlake. Leave me alone.
No. Yeah. I was, you know, you put on Dark Horse from, I've talked about this before. You put on Dark Horse from Katy Perry. I'm gonna bounce around like an idiot in my car.
Dude, totally. You know, like, I just don't care anymore, man. You know, like that AI song really got me when it came out, you know, you know, I just don't give a shit anymore. And I'm not trying to be cool, you know, like if I'm cool, it's because it just happened, you know, like I'm definitely not trying to be. So like, and I really don't care if anybody thinks I am. Yeah, totally. Yeah. It's your fault for thinking I'm cool. I'm not trying to be cool.
Exactly. Cool. But hey, before we jump into wrestling. Beer. Do you drink beer? Beer
at all? I have been known to enjoy a fine beer. Actually, to be honest with you, I like really shitty beer. But I haven't gotten on this IPA train yet. So
okay.
Yeah, it's a little bit. I mean, dude, listen. I'm a Cubs fan my entire life. So
okay.
Shitty old style from Chicago is really my jam, you know. And I do love a really awesome like lager. Or something like that, like a lighter beer. I can't really get into the super hoppy stuff, you know.
Have you tried maltier stuff? Like, what got me hooked was the Belgian quads and like darker, like porters and stuff like that. That's what drew me into that world.
Yeah, see, like I don't really know. And the funny thing is, too, is my girlfriend is a bartender, right? And she makes fun of me about this shit all the time, you know, because she's like, you are like the most fucking. Like pretentious dude in some ways, you know, where I'm like, oh, I would never like that stuff, you know, like, and then you go and you order an old style, you know, like we'll go out to like a fucking get a nice steak or something like that. And it'll be like, drink a wine. I'm like, nah, like what like cheap beer do you have? You know, like, I'm totally the dude that's going to order like a High Life and have like a filet mignon, you know, like, yes. But yeah, you know, I've actually, I'm trying to think of like what this, I think it was 3 acres. They have a couple
half acre.
That's it. Half acre. I fill in at a tattoo shop doing like front desk stuff. And one of the dudes from there came in a couple weeks ago, and the guy that tattooed him doesn't drink beer, but he brought him a couple like 4-packs, and they had a couple IPAs that I was actually really into. I couldn't tell you what they, or one of them was a Shogun or something, like a Samurai. I don't know how hip you are to that.
No, they don't make it out here as much. But I'm familiar with some of their beers. Like I think they have Daisy Cutter or something like that.
Yeah, see, I think that one might be the one I'm not into. Maybe. Who knows, man? I'm very iffy on the beer thing. I love Old Style and High Life. my one brewery that I will say I really like is Bell's. I don't know if you guys get that out there. There's a beer called Oberon is like one of my favorite. I don't know really where that sits. in the beer world, you know. But
well, they just recently got named. Well, they have a beer that got named best beer in the world, and it's a Two Hearted Ale, which is an IPA or a double IPA, I think.
Yeah, I think I've had that before, and I do think I enjoy it.
It's all right. I mean, I like it. It's a solid beer, but I mean, I don't think that's the best fucking beer in the world.
Well, you know, the funny thing is too, man, it's like this goes across the board too. It's like everything is so opinion based, you know. Yeah, like, sure. Yeah. And it's like, you know, hey, you know, it might not be the best beer to you. You never know. You know, like someone else might, you know. I know that I oddly enough, to transition into any sort of wrestling here, I know that Stone Cold is all about the IPAs nowadays. And I've always I wanted to try. Oh hell yeah! You see what you just did there. I've been wanting to try his beer. Have you gotten that out there? Because I know that he has it out in California.
Yeah, dude. My my girl works 2 blocks away from the brewery that makes it. So
no way.
So So I'm there pretty much every day. When I go pick her up, I swing by and I have a couple. You know.
Yeah, of course. Why not? You know, as one does. Yeah. Like.
Yeah. To be fair, when I walked in there, I thought it was going to suck because I was like, dude, this is a gimmick. This is bullshit. You know,
it totally. Yeah, that's what I thought, too.
He stamped his name. He stamped his name on it just to make money. But then I read about it and I saw that he was actually involved and he loves hops and he's all about it. So yeah, I was like, all right.
You know what? He is a for real beer drinker.
Yeah.
You know, and I respect that he lived the gimmick, man. You know, like,
he is Stone Cold.
He is Stone Cold. Yeah. It's like, he's the guy that I've always heard say that the best characters in wrestling are always the guy themselves turned up to 11, you know? Yeah. And I think that more or less he runs at 10 all the time. Is what I can understand, you know, like, so 11 wasn't that far of a stretch for him, you know? And it was cool. Like I listened to his podcast. He talked about it a lot at one point, and I've been meaning to try it. I figured once I get out on tour again, I'm going to kind of take a look for it, you know?
If you do come to the West Coast to California, you know, if you have the time, we can go check it out. And
I would love that.
If not, I'll just bring some to the show if you don't have the time. You know?
Totally, yeah. I would love to. I'd love to get it just in general, you know, just because I have a large wrestling collection. So that would probably work really well.
Yeah, dude, I lucked out. I got super lucky, which I would have to say most of my life I do get lucky with stuff like this. But I met one of the higher-ups at that brewery, and, you know, we were talking about it. I told her, yeah, I'm a big Stone Cold fan. You know, he was in my childhood, basically. So she gave me one of the cans that he used for WrestleMania. They only made a small run of that for WrestleMania.
That rules.
So I have that can right now. So like, I didn't open it at all. Like, the beer's ruined, but
yeah.
I have the sealed can, you know, just...
Dude, that's what's up. That's fucking awesome stuff. Yeah, that's definitely something that it's like, oh yeah, that would be great in my collection. Like, I got to a point where like, I've moved a few times in the last couple of years, and dude, records. I listen to a lot of music in my car, because I drive a lot. So like, vinyl is cool and all, but I only buy like bands I absolutely am. Like obsessed with and loved records, you know. And I also listen, when I listen to music at home, it's usually when I'm drawing or painting, or photoshopping stuff. So getting up to flip a record every 20 minutes is a real pain in the ass, you know. Especially like if you're getting in the groove, like drawing something. Or I mean, there have been times where I have listened to vinyl while I've been drawing, and like it's silent in here for a good 20 minutes just because I don't want to stand up. You know, and get away from what I'm doing. Because, like, once you get in the mode, it's kind of hard. So I kind of got out of buying vinyl. I have, like, maybe 10,000 comic books. And I just got it. Yeah, it's ridiculous, dude. I mean, I've been collecting my entire life, you know. And I just am running out of space, you know. So I basically am now focused just on collecting wrestling stuff. Because the market is so chill on it. It's not super expensive out there. And, you know, like I can, it's really easy to get it, and it's not taking up as much space, for me, you know? So that's kind of been my main focus.
Do you own a replica belt?
Oh, I don't own a baller replica belt yet. Okay. I always said, if I'm going to do it, I want to get the Winged Eagle or the black strapped IC belt, but you know, but like spending $400 on something like that is, that's a little deep, you know?
Yeah. I've been considering it. You know, I've made up my mind that I'm going to do it eventually.
Oh yeah. It's going
to
happen.
I told them I'm going to gift it to myself when I quote unquote make it or whatever. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah,
once I'm at a point, if I'm like financially at a point where like, all right, all my bills are covered and I have an extra couple grand.
Right.
Maybe I'll dump $300 on a belt, you know?
Yeah, totally. Yeah. That's why, you know, like me and my girlfriend were joking the other day because she's I've gotten her into wrestling because you really just can't date somebody that is into wrestling and with as much programming as out there and not get into it because it's on all the fucking time. So she's gotten into it. And I was just joking with her the other day because she lifts weights now. And I was like, you know what we should do is we should get a replica belt and we should totally like have house champion, you know? totally have matches. It's like hardcore rules, you know, 24/7. Like, who's nice. Doing the dishes? All right, let's do it. You know, like, so that was a joke the other day. I don't think it's going to work out. I have a feeling that you might veto that at the end of the day, but I'm holding on to that conversation for sure.
Have you heard the podcast, The Store Horseman?
No.
So there's a comedy place here called The Comedy Store, and they do a podcast where they review pay-per-views, WWE pay-per-views.
Oh, no shit. Okay.
And it's them, it's like Tony Hinchcliffe and a couple other comedians, and they have a belt because they'll have a show before the pay-per-view and make predictions, and then whoever makes the most amount of correct choices becomes the champ and takes a belt.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
That's actually, so I have a couple of friends that always come over too. I think I might need to instill this rule.
you get together, move. You're like, these are my predictions, and then whoever wins at the end of the night gets the belt. And every pay-per-view, the person brings the belt over, and they fight again, you know?
Oh, dude, yeah, that's great. I'm going to bring this up. I'm actually, the show I'm going to this evening is one of my buddies' band is playing, so I'm going to bring this up to him. Because we've been trying to figure out a way to, like, pull this off where we're not actually hurting each other, but we can't figure out a way to do that. So this might actually be the way to, you know, like, not actually give each other concussions to have this belt change hands between us.
Exactly. And you do everybody chip in. If you get a group together, everybody chips in, then that belt just belongs to all of you, and whoever the champ is holds on to it during that time, you know?
Yeah, I love that. That's great, man. That's a great idea. I'm totally bringing this up later. I'm like mentally writing this group text as we're talking right now.
So now that we're like kind of just balls deep into wrestling, let's go for it. Let's talk SummerSlam.
Let's do it, man. I'm in.
So officially announced, we got the four-way, the Braun Strowman, Brock Lesnar, Roman Reigns, Samoa Joe, Fatal Four-Way.
Yeah, no, I'm really stoked about that match. I thought, although I do agree with some of the criticisms of the Joe Lesnar match, being that Joe should have taken
one F5.
Yeah. I still thought Joe looked awesome in that match. I thought he came out totally unscathed, if not actually definitely legitimized him to a lot of people. Like, he's been legit to me for years because I followed him, you know, the Ring of Honor thing and even in TNA at points, you know. And I've always thought Joe is the shit. And so I think that now he's definitely legitimate in a lot of WWE fans' eyes, which is great. I think he should have taken like four F5s. You know,
at least three or four would have been nice.
I assume, you know, though, that Lesnar told him to go home because he was getting tired, because that's the only thing that makes sense, because you know that Lesnar doesn't have more than 10 minutes in him. You know,
he starts turning pink.
Mm-hmm.
And fucking,
he looks like a fucking eggplant out there. It's like disturbing the color he changes to. It's like, it's pretty fucking crazy. And then like, yeah, I couldn't imagine he had more in him. So it made sense to a certain extent to me. But I think with a four way, he has less work to do.
For sure. And he could just go hide outside.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he could go like take a bump and just lay outside for a while. And
yeah,
and
totally chill out.
Fight it out, you know?
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, Strowman is young too. And Roman seems to be like a fucking machine anyway. You know, so I think that there'll be a lot of work to get done in there. And I would love to see the belt come off Lesnar.
I think it will.
I think it will, too. Yeah. I think especially with him going back to UFC, that rumor.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think that they're – I think that WWE is going to let his contract's up after Mania.
Yeah.
Right? So my thought is that they probably don't want their champion in UFC losing.
Yeah.
You know, like if he walked into that fight in November still Universal Champion and he – dude, if he fights John Jones, he's going to get his ass kicked, I think. You know, like John Jones is like the baddest dude on the planet. So I don't think that they're going to – I don't necessarily think that Lesnar will definitely lose to him. But I definitely don't think that Vince McMahon is going to take a chance that his champion at the time is going to lose to a UFC guy. That's not going to work.
No.
You know, so I think that – and it's be smart business. I think that they kind of – I think that Finn getting injured really fucked everything up, you know?
For sure, yeah. All the plans were ruined at that
point. Absolutely, yeah. You know, I mean, and like, in all honesty, like I said in the beginning of this, my suspension of belief is strong.
Yeah.
I can't suspend my belief enough to think that Finn Balor can beat fucking Brock Lesnar, you know?
I thought, you know, I the only way I saw it happening is if, you know, you hold back on the Demon King gimmick and bring that out and fucking play it up. Like,
totally, yeah.
You know how they do the Bray Wyatt, they turn the lights off? If they could figure out a way to do that faster and have, like, him as the Demon King and it's pitch black and he's behind Brock and then it gets pitch black again, now he's in the corner and he's jumping up, like, you know, have, like, flashes.
Totally.
Of him. Yeah. That would be fucking awesome.
You know? Adding some sort of, like, mystical element to it might work, you know, but without that, like, I can't, you know, I mean, it's like The Undertaker is one of those things where it's like, yeah, I totally believe that he's a dead man, you know? Like, yeah. And I don't think they've done quite that good of a job with the whole demon thing yet. Not saying that it can't get there. I mean, I feel like that dude has a bright future anyway. You know, and I think he's going to be around for a while. So, I mean, I think that right now they're just putting him on hold because I can see him beating everybody but Braun and Brock.
Yeah.
You know, and I could see them taking the belt off Lesnar, which I hope they do. And I'll honestly, I hope it's Joe. You know, he seems like the one person that they can watch different people. You know?
Yeah, yeah. I think, you know, to focus only on that match, I think, yeah. I think Lesnar will drop the belt. I think they want to crown Roman Reigns at WrestleMania. I think that's Vince McMahon's dream.
I think so, too. Yeah.
So in between here to Mania, I think Joe and Roman had a really good match.
Absolutely. So that could, yeah,
that could be a good, you know, maybe have Joe and Roman go at it in a feud for a bit and have Joe become champ and have Roman take it from him and have a matchup at WrestleMania with Roman and Brock or something.
Yeah, maybe Cena and Roman at Mania for the, it's going to happen, dude. Just
Cena and Roman at Mania so I can go get food.
Yeah, exactly. That so time. I can leave early and not to caught in traffic and out of there. That's exactly what the plan would be. I know, so stupid, boring. Dude. I hate Roman so much, but actually, this is here's a funny little anecdote for you. I'm a part of a Facebook group that does a tattoo rumble, right?
Tattoo rumble, okay.
Yeah, so we all put in, you know, like our names, and then they pull numbers, just like the rumble, and whatever number you get a tattoo of that person that comes in at that number.
Oh, shit.
So actually, Scott from Neurosis, who's a good friend, is part of this as well. So I forgot who he got. I want to say he maybe got Baron Corbin this year. maybe, which, I mean, I guess you can get a wolf, right? You know? I'm terrible.
At least it's a wolf and it's, you know, he's a metalhead dude, so it's not terrible.
Totally, yeah. I mean, he's an awful wrestler, I think, but it's fine. You know?
He's got a lot of work to do, man. I think they're seeing too much in him. He's got work to do.
Yeah, I think he has a great upside. I just don't think that he's there yet, you know? But regardless of that, I wound up this year last year I pulled 19, which was Dean Ambrose, which I was cool with. I was like, all right, cool.
Nice.
So I got an Ambrose tattoo last year. And then this year I was like, what did I get? And I pulled 30. Oh. So, dude. I'm sitting there and I'm like, dude, it's 30. Who do I get? It's probably going to be Taker, Samoa Joe, or Finn Balor. I am so stoked. And then it was fucking Roman Reigns.
Do you have my Roman Reigns tattoo?
So my entire living room turns around and points at me and is like, oh, you're getting a Roman Reigns tattoo. And I'm like, son of a bitch. I cannot believe that just happened. My Facebook group, as soon as he came out, condolences started. But in the end, I wound up getting the number 30 with a banner that says anyone but you. So I'm actually kind of into that tattoo. So I'm okay with it. Yeah.
All right.
I did tweet it at him. I didn't hear anything back, though. So
the fucking Superman punch Michael Jordan thing they're trying to sell now with the shirt.
Dude, yeah, I hate it. Dude, I'm also a huge Jordan fan for the record. So like I'm really against it. You know, like.
All right, so let's go back. So, prediction. Who's winning that fight, that match?
I'm going Joe.
I'm going to go Braun.
Oh, that's a bold move.
I'm going to go Braun. I think that they're going to give it to Braun and then maybe have Joe and Braun go at it because that's never happened one-on-one.
I could also see Brock and Braun.
I think Brock's going to go on a break.
Probably, yeah. Yeah, I don't think he's going to get much work.
Yeah, so I think Braun and Joe feud for a bit and then have Joe and Roman feud for WrestleMania, maybe. That'd be cool.
Yeah, I could get into that for sure.
Yeah. So that's what I'm going to say Braun. I'm going to hope for Braun.
All right. We're going to have to touch base after this to see how we do.
Yeah.
So I got Joe on this one for sure, though.
All right. And then Naomi versus Natalia. I'm going to be asleep during that match.
Yeah, dude, that's such a weird thing. I do think that Natalia, though, is a good hand. I don't like her at all, but I know she's a great wrestler. She really is. And she has a pedigree, you know.
Sure.
I think it's cool that they kind of swerved us. I could have sworn it was Charlotte. Why wouldn't it have been Charlotte? She's the best fucking women's wrestler of all time. You know?
Sure.
But I'm going to go Naomi on that one anyway. Or actually, I should say Carmella.
Oh, yeah. That's probably what's going to happen.
Yeah, I could see that happening for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm going to say Naomi with the then cash-in situation as well. So.
But see, the other thing is, too, though, is that, so, you know, there's a leaked SummerSlam poster. Spoiler alert. that it has Jinder, Cena, and Nakamura on it.
Yeah. So that's one of the matches that's rumored. So, like, next week we got Cena versus Nakamura. I predict Baron Corbin bullshit interruption.
Absolutely. Definitely a schmoz finish on that one. And I definitely foresee, like, them it being a triple threat, because you know that card is going to be 4 hours, but they're still going to fucking not be able to get everybody on there.
Yeah.
You know? So I'm assuming that we're going to get a triple threat between those three, which is weird. And I could see Corbin cashing in on that.
On Jinder?
Yeah. I could totally see that. Because I don't think they're going to let Nakamura lose. You know, like clean at least, you know, like,
no.
So I'm assuming that that might be a thing, because then they could set up, you know, Baron Nakamura for the title.
Yeah, which they, you know, they've been leading to that feud as it is. So, yeah, that makes sense. Have Nakamura pin one of the two guys, have them become champ, and then have Baron come in and cash in and kick his ass and take it, you know?
Totally. Or even him pin Jinder, or I could see him pinning Cena. Cena's like, I feel, has become quite the team player. In the last few years, yeah,
he's definitely doing a lot of favors for sure.
Absolutely, I could see him eating a pin to put somebody over, and therefore, Jinder doesn't lose the title clean, and then Nakamura can, you know, challenge Baron Corbin for it.
True.
Yeah.
Yeah. That sounds good to me. Alexa Bliss versus Bayley.
I gotta go Alexa Bliss. I fucking hate Bayley.
She's the worst.
She is female Cena, is what she is, and I John Cena is the reason I stopped watching wrestling for a little while. And she is just the worst. I don't understand why Sasha Banks did not get that match.
Yeah, that was weird.
It was weird. Dude, Sasha and her like put on a pretty decent match besides that ending. And I thought that was kind of whack that she didn't get it. I was a big fan of Sasha. I kind of hate the whole hot potato her and Charlotte played with the title.
Yeah.
But, you know, I would love to see some more Sasha Alexa. So, but I got to go Alexa because I think she's actually pretty great, at least on the mic. I don't think she's necessarily great in the ring yet, but a lot of upside.
Yeah, I like Alexa. I think she's perfect right now, but I know that they want to turn her face.
You think so?
Yeah, dude, she's over with the crowd. Mm-hmm. They're going to want to turn her.
That's a good point.
I think what they're going to do, they might give the belt to Bayley and then have Sasha turn heel.
That might be the thing, yeah.
Yeah, have Alexa and Sasha do a double turn or whatever they call it.
Yeah, the old double turn. It's a hard thing to pull off.
I think they could pull it off. Have Alexa and Sasha feud for number one contender against Bayley. Have the double turn, and then have Sasha go for the belt against Bayley.
Yeah, that's probably a good point. Yeah, that's probably – I could see that working out very well. Although they've been teasing that Sasha turn forever now. You know?
Yeah.
So who fucking knows?
Yeah, and that's the other thing is, whatever makes sense, the WWE likes to go the other direction.
Oh, always. Yeah. They are the kings of that shit.
Well, it's Vince McMahon's pride. It's like, hey, oh, you think you got us figured out, huh? I'll show you.
Yeah, fucking... Dude, yeah, he's almost like self-destructive. He's like a kid that's just like, oh yeah, you want to play with my favorite toy, then I'm gonna kill all of the favorite toys. You know, it's like,
yeah.
All right.
None of us get toys.
Yeah, exactly. I'm gonna set all of our toys on fire. It's like, Jesus Christ, Vince, chill the fuck out. Man. You're like a kind of a hero to me to a certain extent because you shaped my childhood, but stop fucking with me, man. Like,
yeah, Jesus. That's the thing, dude. Like, I love him for, you know, providing a product that I've enjoyed my whole youth and now. But at the same token, I can't wait for him to go away.
Oh, man. Yeah, I'm really waiting for Triple H to take this motherfucker over. Like, he's done such a good job with NXT, you know, and I could only imagine him running the main roster. I think he'd do a killer job.
Hell yeah.
Except for the fact that he won't job for anybody.
Oh, no.
You know? Like, him beating Sting at WrestleMania was pretty ridiculous. But
I'm surprised he took a pin from Rollins, though. He fucking built up Rollins. Yeah.
Me too, but that's his boy, though. He's an NXT guy. You know, Sting was a WCW guy, and he fucked up. He should have gone to WWE a long time ago. So
for sure, we never got our Undertaker versus Sting match.
Yeah, absolutely. We never will, you know? So thanks, Sting.
Another SummerSlam rumor is KO versus Shano.
Yeah, I'm actually kind of interested in that. I was very upset that my main dude at the moment, and maybe he's turned into an all-timer for me, is AJ Styles. I've always loved his stuff in the indie scene. I loved him in NJPW, and I really was expecting them to fuck with him so hard in WWE. I was so stoked when he came in, and they haven't. I honestly feel that they're like trying to give him a run with every title so he can have like that resume in WWE, which is really cool of them.
Yeah,
and I'm glad, and I think he deserves every bit of every ounce of credit. And when I heard about him going against Shane at Mania, I was like, you gotta be fucking kidding me. You know, like, that's such bullshit. Like, but they put on a great match, man.
Yeah.
You know, and I forget, you know, Shane's a maniac. You know, and Kevin Owens is a maniac.
Yeah.
You know, like, him building, it's like a ladder something or another, like a TLC match. Holy fuck.
Yeah, yeah. They're gonna kill each other. I'm pretty sure KO is gonna murder Shane and like do some like maybe like what do they call that? The apron bomb or something?
Oh yeah, the apron bomb, yeah, or whatever it's called, yeah.
Oh my god. I
think it could be a crazy
apron bomb.
Yeah, dude, I feel like that could be a really violent, awesome match. So yeah. I'm actually kind of for it. Like I said, I feel like he's really surprised me with AJ. And although I would have rather had AJ in a more premier spot, I guess there is the argument that what is more premier than facing the son of Vince McMahon?
Right, right.
Right? You know, like, that is pretty fucking big, you know?
You can't face Vince anymore, so here's the son.
Yeah, and dude, like, fuck, dude, he's always been a maniac.
Yeah.
You know, I'm for it. So, like,
that match with Kurt Angle back in the, I think it was Triple H and Kurt Angle, and where they threw him through the frickin' glass.
Yeah, that was bananas. You know, or when he jumped off the Titantron.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Holy shit. Like, dude, the guy's a crazy bastard. He just survived a fucking helicopter crash.
Yeah.
You know, like, he's clearly we don't give him enough credit. So I'm hoping that actually does happen. That sounds fun.
So do you think that Vince McMahon really thinks he's God and his son is Jesus? He can't die.
Yeah, I do. I'm actually completely sold on that gimmick. Like, no, I live in the kayfabe on that one, dude. You know, like, no doubt.
For sure. Other things I have here listed, rumors. These are not confirmed. Like, I think that AJ is going to go against Jericho for the SummerSlam for the U.S. title.
See, it seems weird to me, and it seems really whatever. But I don't know what else they can do.
Yeah, yeah.
You know?
I mean, it is whatever, but it is also AJ's first story.
That's true.
In the WWE.
Yeah, that's true.
Maybe he retires Jericho.
Oh, that could be a thing, although I don't ever want Chris Jericho to go away.
Yeah.
Then again, they can do a retired match all they want. It doesn't matter. Yeah. You know, like, everyone comes back, man. So
I'm back, baby! Yeah.
Dude, I love Chris Jericho. And you know what, dude? This last run he had may have been my favorite of all time. He was fucking fantastic, you know?
His best work.
Dude, yeah, absolutely. You know, he is the king, as far as I'm concerned. So, like, that could be fun. I mean, they put on a great match just before, so I could see that being good. But I just hold AJ in such high regard that I would hope more for him. But then again, I don't see who else he could face. So Jericho is a pretty, pretty good. I think the KO matches too have been kind of shitty. So
yeah.
I think Jericho would work. I mean, it would be totally fine, not necessarily exciting, you know?
Right.
So
I got the Shield versus the Bar versus the Club versus the Revival.
Oh, wow. The Shields? Oh, yeah, you're right. I am looking at that right now. Holy shit. I pulled up the card as well.
Seth Rollins and Dean Ambrose as partial Shield, I guess.
Yeah, partial Shield, part of the Shield.
Yeah,
not a full Shield, so not completely protected. Nah. I don't know about all that. The tag scene is weird. I don't know what they're doing with Gallows and Anderson.
Yeah, they came out as babyfaces last week, didn't they?
They did, but I don't know if they are or not. Now I could see them doing that and then like helping out Finn, because I don't see them turning Finn heel anytime soon.
They need to reunite Finn with the Club, man.
They really do. Yeah, they all walk around doing the too sweet thing. You know, like, are we just supposed to ignore that? You know, like, we gotta figure that shit out. You know, so I would assume that might be a thing too. So that would be kind of cool. I would prefer them not to be jobbers. You know, like, they're great in the ring. They're awesome wrestlers. I don't understand what the fucking problem is here. You know.
Yeah.
I like Cesaro and Sheamus. The Bar. You have the Bar, if you will. It's such a dumb name, but yeah. I have enjoyed them. I always liked Cesaro's work, you know. I never thought he really did anything worthwhile, though. So this is kind of cool. I don't really know. I'm waiting for the Hardys to get broken.
Yeah.
So are they part of that or no?
I didn't say their name, but I do have them listed as, like, something has to happen with the Hardys at SummerSlam.
Obviously, and I think, yeah, totally.
I think breaking them at SummerSlam would be good. Maybe with the Revival, you know? Just fucking Revival breaks the Hardys, and then have, like, the Shield, the Bar, and the Club go at it. I don't know.
Yeah. I don't know how that would really work out as far as any of them but Cesaro and Sheamus or the Revival being the champions. So I'm going to have to go Revival on that, just because I think those guys are fucking great.
Yeah.
And they probably need the title more than anybody else, you know?
I suspect that they want to give the titles to this weird Shield reunion that's going to happen.
Oh, I hate that. But I actually really want Ambrose to turn heel on Rollins. I think that's the only way that Rollins is ever going to get over as a face, you know?
That's true.
And I think that Dean would be, at this point, he's so tired and stale that I think him being a heel and being a crazy bastard finally. Because, I mean, I thought he was going to be the one to turn. And then it was Seth.
Yeah.
You know? So this all has gotten weird to me. And I think that Ambrose is in desperate need of a switch up here, you know?
Definitely. He needs to go wild and crazy and more violent.
Absolutely. And he can, you know? Like, why isn't he?
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I mean, that's what he came from, man. CZW.
Yeah. I mean, I always picture him with a super bloody face, you know? Like, Crimson Mask all the way, man, you know? Like,
for sure. Yeah, the only other notes I have, I think that we'll get a Demon King versus Bray Wyatt match.
Yeah, which I'm assuming that's obviously Finn. I'm also reading New Day versus Usos, which I thought that match was the only good match at Battleground, by the way.
It was. It was the first match, and it was the only good one.
Yeah, it really was a very steady decline from there. I think
the Great Khali.
So bad. I actually really like the Usos nowadays. I hated them as faces. These gangster heels, though, I'm actually pretty into.
Yeah.
And I think the New Day will probably retain that, though, for sure.
Dude, they already made a fucking replica New Day tag belt.
Are you serious?
With, like, green and, like, the ice cream on the leather and stuff.
Oh, Jesus. Okay. Yeah, so they're probably going to retain then. I also think that a feud between them and Breezango might be the funniest thing I ever see. So,
oh my God,
I'm kind of hoping that's a thing. That would be into it, too. I like the New Day. So they're all great workers. I really want Big E to be the first black heavy world champion, though. So I would like him. I think he's incredible.
Yeah.
You know, I think he deserves it for sure.
Yeah. He definitely needs a singles run, I think.
I think so, too. I think he's fucking great. You know, and I know Kofi's winding down, too, you know, and I think he's the one, you know. I think he's the chosen one in my eyes.
Yeah.
It also says The Miz versus Jason Jordan.
Oh, God, is that going to happen?
That's what it says on what I'm reading. That was the rumored matches. See, you're like, what? Why isn't Finn going for the IC title?
He should.
Why
not? I think.
Like, you know, like, come on.
He should be doing something else. Not feuding with fucking cowboy acoustic guitar guy.
Yeah, dude, the drift.
Sorry, dude.
Not into it, dude.
Fuck. No, dude, I'm sorry. Yeah, he was funny when he was insane shit and just kind of drifting in the background. I thought that was great.
I thought that was really cool, actually. I thought that was a great introduction to him, you know? And it works for the character so well, but, like, now I'm just like, whatever about this guy.
he you know, totally botched that guitar hit.
Totally, like,
I don't know, man. I want him out of the picture. Finn, I was so excited, and, like, they've just been not doing anything with him. Hopefully this Bray thing doesn't blow as hard as the House of Horrors with Randy Orton.
Oh, my God. I don't even want to think about that.
They could fuck this up real bad, dude.
Dude, that was so bad, dude. And especially, they could fuck this. They've been fucking up Bray since he got on the main roster.
Yeah.
So, like, you know, I mean, that guy, he should have been the one to beat The Undertaker. You know, like, honestly.
Definitely. He should have passed the torch to him. Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. Like, are you talking about? He could have been the next Undertaker, in all honesty. You know, and he's so fucking over. I don't understand why he just keeps losing. So, who knows?
Yeah, and him losing is only making his promos not work. Like,
nobody's going to
believe that you're like, oh, you're a god. Okay, well, you lose all the damn time.
Yeah, or only win when someone else helps you.
Yeah.
You know, and I don't understand how they dude, Cena put him over two nights in a row.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, for the title? Come on. What the fuck?
Yeah.
I don't understand it. It seems like someone has an out for him. Maybe, like, maybe IRS backstage is not a great worker, so he just keep taking it out on his kid.
Yeah, right?
Fuck. It's all Mike Rotunda fucking this up.
Maybe he got punished for, what was it? He cheated on his wife, apparently, with one of the announcers.
With JoJo. He's kind of a hero, you know? Like, I was like, go Bray, my man, you know? Like, holy shit. That's pretty epic.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Well, I mean, other than that, I think maybe a cruiserweight match. I'm sure we'll get at the kickoff or something.
Which, like some now that Austin Aries is gone, dude, I don't even care.
Yeah, it'll be a pointless three-way with like Arya Devani and Neville and
Rich.
What's that Tozawa.
Yeah, or Rich Swann. And I don't even know, dude. Like, unless they bring in Ricochet, which I saw a tweet the other day. That he posted a picture of Ricochet posted a picture of him as a kid meeting Triple H, and he said, "Happy birthday, buddy. See you soon."
Yeah.
So if Ricochet comes, I could get really excited.
Well, but they're gonna have to do a run. They're gonna put him in NXT for sure.
You think so?
First, yeah.
I could see them putting him right into 205.
It's possible.
I think they need someone to fucking go against Neville. I can't believe any of these guys can beat Neville.
Well, they need to move some people around, man.
Mm-hmm. Like, oh, sure do.
I think Enzo should be in 205. I think Kalisto should be in 205.
Yeah, absolutely. Sin Cara should be too.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I mean, they need to do something with that show because I lost Talking Smack, and I'm certainly not going to make me watch 205 anymore if I can't watch Talking Smack after it. So, you know,
I don't think I've ever watched a full episode of 205 Live.
I did the first like few times, and right after it started airing, I think maybe within the first month of it airing, they were in Chicago. So we went and saw SmackDown and then saw 205. So I saw that for sure. But since then, it's been, you know, I can't tell you the last time I watched any of it, let alone even part of it, you know?
Yeah, I think the last match I watched was like the street fight with Kendrick and someone else. Who was it? TJ? No.
Was it Jack? Tozawa? Jack, yeah. Oh, yeah. You know, I didn't watch that. Yeah.
Yeah, it was Tozawa and Kendrick, and it was good though. There was a really crazy like table spot, and I enjoyed it. So that, but other than that,
it's super garbage, man. I don't understand what the fuck they're thinking with that. It's a really hard show to watch. I have like the characters are terrible. Mm-hmm. Considering how good the Cruiserweight Classic was, I can't believe how hard they have dropped the ball on this. It almost seems impossible. But then again, it's WWE. You know, you can't put anything past them.
Yeah, and they're doing a good job with NXT. I mean, we got Bobby Roode and Aleister Black and McIntyre.
Yeah, McIntyre, I like better than I ever have. I would love Adam Cole to come up. Holy shit! I hear it's supposed to happen. It's just a matter of when. You know.
Yeah. Yeah.
So you know, I mean, there's we'll they need the, they also NXT needs a little a shot in the arm though too. So. You know.
Yeah, they lost a lot of people.
They did. So, yeah. So we'll see how all that goes now. being a wrestling fan, it's such a kick in the balls.
Yeah, dude, you know, and it sucks because it's not very rewarding.
It's not. Most of the time. It's not. No, yeah. And I've had to explain that to my girlfriend. I was like, because she's, like I said, just recently, the last few years, started to actually watch it and enjoy it with me. Mm-hmm. And she's like, why? Why is this happening? You know? It's like, I'm like, oh, sweetheart. You have many, many disappointing moments to come.
Honey.
Yeah. That's darling. You know, I remember those feelings. You know, but here I am. You know, I like I said, I have given up on it at some points and I always come back to it. So, and I've been pretty into it. I think I care a lot about it, but at the same time, I can let go and just enjoy it a lot now more than I used to be able to. So it's kind of good because I'm not sitting here like, oh, fuck wrestling, you know, like I'm done. So like that's kind of good, you know, but it's a hard thing to have maintained fandom for all these years. You know, they've definitely given me a lot of reasons to walk away.
Yeah, I walked away for a while. I walked away after Stone Cold walked away.
Yeah, pretty much me, too. That was my time as well. I was like, all right, you know. Yeah. It was all fun.
I missed the whole Daniel Bryan, CM Punk bullshit.
Sure.
I missed all of
that. You know, I always kept tabs, but I kind of missed a lot of it. But being from Chicago, I did pay attention to CM Punk.
Okay.
And I would occasionally check in, you know. And then once I started getting into more like the indie stuff and paying attention to that, it just kind of, you know, it was like a snowball effect. I just fell back down the mountain, you know. And the fact of the matter is that like it's so easy to watch WWE now. Once the network came out, I kind of just fell back in because it was just so easy.
Yeah.
You know, like I couldn't imagine paying for all those pay-per-views for all those years. And maintaining of being a fan, you know, like that seems insane. Now that it's so cheap, I can't really help it, you know?
Yeah,
so,
that's really what got me back in too. I got the network, I got the free trial for like 3 months.
Right, yeah.
And I'm like, holy shit, I can watch all the old pay-per-views?
Exactly.
And I started going back and I watched it all in chronological order. I watched all the big four, like WrestleMania, Survivor Series, SummerSlam, and Royal Rumble. I watched all of them chronologically from the first one to now. And then I was like, all right, well, now I'm going to start watching WCW shit and ECW shit. And then
exactly. Yeah. You start watching the documentaries and then all of a sudden you start watching the TV shows on there. It's like all of a sudden you're just in, man. That's how it happened to me too. I actually signed up for it and I was like, well, I've seen all the old stuff, but I'll watch it again. And then I saw that it was it like the big challenge? It was like I think it was the same year as WrestleMania 2. Mm. It's like it was in Chicago and it was just a tournament, but it was called the big event, I think it's called. Check it out. It's really interesting. It's I'd never even heard about it. And like we're talking about a time that I was like bananas about wrestling, you know, like I had all the VHS, you know, like I had all that stuff and I never even heard of that pay-per-view. Hmm. So like I was really excited to see that because it was something from that era that I never saw.
Yeah.
You know, and it was like, you know, Lord Alfred Hayes and like I think Corporal Kirshner was on there, you know, like all these old jobbers, you know. And then I don't know if you've ever gone into it, but the Tuesday Night Titans thing.
No, I've seen it, but I haven't gotten into
Dude,
it.
Dude, you should go through that because there are some awful, awful gems on there. You know, like Special Delivery Jones playing with like a Caribbean band. Dude, yeah. So I would definitely peruse that that show a bit because that was a bit before my time, or at least I don't remember it because I was a small child when that was airing. But, yo, that shit was hilarious. You should definitely check it out. Some golden age shit that's worth it.
I'll check it out for sure.
Absolutely.
Well, cool, dude. It's an hour and 15, so I think I'm going to wrap up here.
Right on, man. I got to jump in the shower and go see Negative Approach, I think. So,
hell yeah. Hell yeah. thanks for your time, dude. Social media plugs. If you want to.
Yeah. Well, we're on everything. Instagram, Twitter, and the Facebooks, The Atlas Moth. I run all of them, or you can find me on them too. So, you know, catch me if you can, I guess.
Right, right. Yeah, you got some shows in October.
Yeah, we're playing, I think it's October 6th at Reggie's in Chicago with Perturbator. And then I think our record, here's your scoop, your official scoop, I think it's February 9th. Oh,
okay.
Is the release date for Coma Noir. So album number 4 will be out and we'll be on the road.
Fantastic.
Fuck awesome, yeah. Man. Awesome.
Well, hopefully you guys hit the road west and I can see you guys once you come back.
That'll be the plan, man. You let me know. I'll put you on the guest list and we can touch base again after one of these events here and fucking see how we did picking our winners for SummerSlam.
hell yeah. Hell yeah. We'll touch base on that and yeah, I'll bring you some fancy ass beers at the.
I will drink all the fancy ass beers because I don't know any better. So you can teach me something.
Some stone cold beer,
man. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. Oh, hell yeah, if you will.
A Steve Weiser.
A Steve Weiser. I'm all about some Steve Weisers, man.
All right, brother. Well, thanks again, brother. And cheers.
Absolutely, man. Yeah, man. Talk to you soon.